And what a privilege and what a joy to be here to see a couple of our students get baptized. You know, we have 10 centers here in Southern California with close to 700 students. And to see a couple of our students get baptized today is just a tremendous blessing and a great privilege. And may the power of the Holy Spirit continue to minister to them as they go forward to the next stages. Amen. And again, I want to add my also blessing to Laura and Tim. So good to see you. I had a chance to visit with Tim at the center as he's returned the last couple of weeks after the stroke. And we're believing God for complete and total restoration of all things. Can somebody say amen? Hallelujah. God has already done many miracles. And we celebrate what God has done in your life. And Laura, we bless you in the great ministry that you lead, Northeast of the Well, ministering to women who have lives that have been broken by all kinds of addictions, and they're being set free by the power of the gospel. So we bless the Northeast of the Well ministry, and so honored to have you here. She's a great leader and a great minister of the gospel. Thank you, Laura, for serving. Amen. Love you. Hallelujah. You know, the Ministry of Teen Challenge continues to march around the world. We're in about 130 nations of the world now. And here in Southern California, we want to open up some new centers because the need is so great. We have about 2.7 million, almost 3 million drug addicts and alcoholics that call the Southland their home, that live in Southern California. That's a lot of folks. That's according to the State Bureau of Statistics of the state of California. So we have a lot of people who need help. We have 700 beds approximately in our centers in Southern California. But there are other communities that Teen Challenge is not reaching right now in our area of Southern California that we want to reach to. And so we've launched the New Life Expansion Vision to go into some new communities, the Antelope Valley, up on the Santa Maria Valley, up on the coast. Also in South LA, we don't have anything viable in South Central Los Angeles, and also in East LA. And the need is so great. Fentanyl has invaded all of the different things that people are occupying their addictions with, and it's deadly, and it's killing a lot of people. Approximately 130 people die from drug overdose every day in the United States. That's a lot of people. 130 every single day, and in some areas around the country, it has really decimated communities. But we know the answer. For more than 60 years, God has used the Ministry of Teen Challenge to bring hope and deliverance to individuals and families and lift up communities around the country and around the world. And so we want to go into more of those communities. So we're working in those places right now. And hopefully in the next couple of months, we will open a new office in Lancaster, Palmdale area, so that we will begin to do outreach in the community for Teen Challenge there. And then we're also looking in the Coachella Valley and the other places that I mentioned. So pray for us at Southern California Teen Challenge. We have a lot to manage already, but when I look and I see the need, I say, Lord, we can't just stop where we are. We must go and reach more of these individuals and families who are dying from drug overdose. And I'm so grateful for this church who has been an anchor of support to cause the ministry to flourish here in Orange County. So we're looking forward to new things from the Lord. Say with me, new things from the Lord. Amen. He's always doing new things and bringing them to pass by his prophetic word. And I believe that he has prophetically spoken to us to step out. And so we're stepping out in faith, and our board is on board with us reaching these new communities. And we're so grateful for our wonderful board here for the Teen Challenge in Southern California. And love Pastor Drew and how he comes down and ministers to the students, is always there for the graduations, and just a tremendous, tremendous heart. And a tremendous blessing. You are blessed here at this congregation to have Pastor Drew as your pastor. Somebody better say amen up in here. Hallelujah. Amen. And I was excited to see his passion and enthusiasm. He's almost Pentecostal. Amen. Praise God. We're getting there. Hallelujah. In case we forgot, the Assemblies of God is a Pentecostal ministry. Hallelujah. And so it's okay to make some noise and be a little undignified and just shout and scream and yell, hallelujah, amen. It lets folks know you're alive, amen. Sometimes I think one of the reasons we're losing a lot of people in this generation to the church is they don't know if there's any life in the church. But I want you to know that as long as the Holy Ghost is here, there is life, There's deliverance. There is salvation. There is healing. There is redemption. There is mercy and there is grace. And we need to be excited about that. Amen? Amen. Amen. Paul told the church in Romans chapter 12, verse 11, he says for us to be excited. Amen. He says, be diligent in business and be fervent in spirit and serve as unto the Lord. Fervent in spirit means to be passionate. Make some noise. Hallelujah. And so I'm fervent in spirit. And every time I come here, I feel like sometimes I'm a little too loud and a little too much. But I tell you, Pastor Drew's catching up. And I see the church is getting on fire here. So I'm excited about the progress and the change going on. It's all good. Amen. Praise the Lord. So you have stepped into a place that honors the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And we're not ashamed to say it. Amen? Amen. Amen. Any Pentecostal folks here? Amen. Praise God. You know, our Pentecostal distinctive does not segregate and separate us from the body of Christ, because I really believe that one of the messages that God has really been breathing into the earth for the church is to have a spirit of unity, where we all work together no matter what the label is over our door. But God also loves variety. Amen. Just look around. We all look a little different up in here. And so God loves variety. And it's okay for us to be who God's called us to be. I remember 44 years ago, I stepped into the doors of the First Assembly of God Church in Marianna, Florida, where I grew up in the South. Very segregated. All the blacks lived on one side of the tracks, and everybody else lived on the other side of the tracks. And I went on the other side of the tracks and went to the church. And I was introduced to the Holy Spirit. I grew up in a Baptist church, didn't know anything about the Holy Spirit. And they taught me at the Assemblies of God Church about the Holy Spirit. And I was filled with the Holy Spirit in that place 44 years ago for the first time. And I want you to know that God has been faithful over the years to continue to reveal himself. And I want us to know that our roots as a ministry go far and deep. And I'm excited about what God is doing in this new season. Amen. Because people need to see a real Jesus with real power bringing real solutions and real answers to their lives. Amen. And when you are desperate and you're in desperate need, it don't matter if the person is talking in tongues or not. You just need some help. Amen. And Jesus said that he will send us a helper. He said he was going to the Father, and he said, I'm not going to leave you as orphans. I'm not going to leave you alone, but I'm going to send you a comforter. I will send you a helper. He'll be in you. He'll be with you. He'll lead and guide you in all truth and true to his word, because Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. The Holy Spirit came into the earth. Hallelujah. And he's been here ever since, birthed the church. Amen. And he's moving, hallelujah, all over the earth. I'm excited about Jesus. I'm excited about the present day move of the Spirit of God in the earth. I'm excited about people coming to know Jesus. Are you excited about Jesus today? Amen. Hallelujah! Amen. Hallelujah. I just returned from Nairobi, Kenya. I was in Africa ministering at an international pastors conference there for pastors from all over East Africa. And they have some particular challenges that they're facing in that part of the world. But the Spirit of the Lord brought comfort to them in some very powerful ways. And my prayer is that God will comfort us by the Holy Spirit today. Because it's only out of the comfort that we receive that we have anything to give to other people. Amen. Are you receiving comfort from the Holy Spirit? If he's forgiven you of your sins, then you have bowels of mercy to forgive other people who do wrong to you. Amen. If he has healed you and brought comfort to your body and healed you, you will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. If he has delivered you from an addiction, then you have a bowels of mercy for those who are struggling with addiction, and you will be patient and you will labor long with them until you see them come to the deliverance that God has for them. And so God wants to continue to give comfort to his people so that we can receive the fullness of his grace in this season and this hour. The word of the Lord today I want to share with you from Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 1 and 2. Because I really believe that in this season, God is building and reconstituting the church in such a way that we will be powerful and effective in these last days. And there was a recent survey that the Barna Institute did on the state of the church in 2020. And They were asking pastors what was on their mind, and 72% of pastors from non-mainline and mainline churches say that the impact of the watered-down gospel teaching on Christianity in the U.S. is a great concern. We've watered the gospel down to try to make everyone feel comfortable. I want you to know the comfort that we need comes from the Holy Spirit, not from a program that we take the meat and the heart out of the gospel. Amen. So the real comfort that we need is not making people feel comfortable in their brokenness, not making them feel comfort in their sin, but the real comfort they need is an introduction to Jesus Christ. Amen. That was a good place to shout hallelujah. Because Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there is no other. Jesus Christ is the way. And that's what people need to know. They need to know the truth that Jesus came into the earth to forgive sin. Jesus came into the earth to redeem. Jesus came into the earth to restore. And it's through his blood that was shed on the cross. And we're not ashamed to talk about the blood. We're not ashamed to talk about the cross. We're not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. For it truly is the power that brings salvation. Do you believe that today? Amen. And so that's one of the things that pastors are concerned about. Another thing they're concerned about is a major concern for Christianity culture's shift to a secular age, that there's more of a secular age that has come upon us. And another one, 63%, poor discipleship models, that we don't do a good job of discipling people once they come into the church. But I want you to know that that paradigm is changing. When churches like this who are teaching and training and discipling people in the faith, can you say amen? Okay, amen. Amen, hallelujah. But when they asked pastors individually about their local church, what they were concerned about, these were trends that in the church in general in America, but the things that were on most pastors' hearts in their own local church was, how can I attract younger people to come into the church? And the decline of consistent evangelism and outreach. Every part and every member of the body has a function. Hallelujah. And we're going to see in a moment that one of the lessons from the book of Nehemiah is that there was a unity that God brought for his purpose and his plan to be established. Amen. And so when we all get out, I'm so glad to hear about knocking on the doors and all the wonderful things that you're doing. We have to create our own paradigm for evangelism and outreach in the context that God has placed us in. And we don't do that unless we get outside and start discovering how to do those things. And I'm so excited to hear about what is happening here, that the church here is doing that. So the Lord is growing this fellowship. I said the Lord is growing this fellowship. I said the Lord is growing this fellowship. The Lord is growing this fellowship. The Lord is growing this fellowship. Hallelujah. Pastor Drew, the Lord is with you. He would never leave you, and he would never forsake you, brother. I pray for you often. And I know the challenge of the ministry and the pastors in this season. But God has filled you with a vision, and he's going to bring to pass his vision, just like he did with his servant Nehemiah. In Nehemiah chapter 4, when Sanballat heard that they were rebuilding the wall, he became very angry and was greatly incensed. He ridiculed the Jews, and in the presence of his associates and the army of Samaria, he said, "What are these feeble Jews doing? Will they restore the wall? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they finish in a day? Can they bring the stones back to life from those heaps of rubble, burned as they are?" I believe that these are the five questions that come to undermine our faith. Five questions that undermine our faith came from Sanballat, this enemy of the people of God, says, "What are these feeble Jews doing?" In other words, you are so weak that you have no ability to fulfill what God has said. This can be individually in our lives. There's vision and purpose and destiny that God has given to us for our families, for our businesses, and for the things that he has involved us in our lives, and also for the church. And the enemy comes to try to undermine our confidence in God to say, "You can't do it. You're too weak." Philippians 4:13 says, "I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. Hallelujah. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. Do you believe that today? Hallelujah. The next question that he asked was, will they restore the wall? Will they restore this wall? Can it be done? Can it be accomplished? Can you build? Can you stand? Can you accomplish what God has said? When God speaks a word, he backs up his word with the power and the force of himself and all the angelic hosts of heaven. And so, yes, it can be rebuilt. It can be done. I can receive my healing. I can receive total restoration. My marriage will thrive. My children will declare the praises of God, and they will serve God, and they will come and walk in his will. Can somebody say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. But the enemy always comes to try to taunt and undermine our faith. He says, will they offer sacrifice? Hallelujah. The sacrifices of God are a broken and a contrite heart. When we humble ourselves and we bring our brokenness before the Lord, God does come and receive those sacrifices of praise. In that one, will they restore the wall? God is a God of restoration. Joel chapter 2, 25, write that down. God says, I will restore to you all that the cankerworm and the palmerworm and the locust have eaten. In other words, all the destructive forces of the enemy that has come to eat away at your confidence, come to eat away at the very fabric of your life. God says, I'm moving in the sanctuary of my power, and I will restore you. Hallelujah. And the glory of this latter house will be greater than the glory of the former house, because the knowledge of the glory of God is covering the earth as the waters cover the sea. God is not done with us. The church is his idea. Salvation is of the Lord. Hallelujah. And what God said he would do, he will fully accomplish by the power of himself. Hallelujah. We don't need Jesus and something else. Amen. We just need the Lord. How many of you say, I need the Lord today? Amen. I want you to know the Lord is for you and he's not against you. And so whatever the voice of the enemy that has been coming against you to try to discourage you and to pull you out of that place of perseverance, to pull you out of that place of faith, you stand and you declare the word of God, because the word of faith is near you. It's in your heart and it's in your mouth. That's the gospel that we preach. And you begin to declare to the mountain, you declare to the circumstance, you declare to the voice of the enemy, I will live and not die. Hallelujah. The ministry will grow and prosper in the name of the Lord. And my health shall return in due time as I wait upon the Lord, because he's the one who renews my strength. Can somebody say amen? Thank you, Lord. Will they offer sacrifice? John chapter 4, verse 23 and 24 says, the Father is looking for worshipers who will worship him in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah. Our worship is a lifestyle. It's not just what we do on Sunday morning, a wonderful time of singing the songs of the Lord here today. But I want you to know that you can draw a circle around yourself and you can sing the Lord's song everywhere you are. Amen. Even in a strange land. Remember, the children of Israel, they hung their harps on a willow tree and said they couldn't sing the Lord's song in a foreign, in a strange land. Sometimes the world seems strange. As we said, one of the concerns that pastors have is the secularism of our world and society here in the United States. But I want you to know, it may look a little strange, but you can still declare the glory of God right in your community, in the restaurant, in the gym. Hallelujah. Anywhere you go, you can still say the name of Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah. And we need to say his name more in public to let people know where we stand. Hallelujah. I was recently at a restaurant with some friends here in at the South Coast Mall, and we got excited. We were talking about the Lord, and there was about five or six brothers around the table, and we were quoting scriptures and saying, glory to God. And all of a sudden, I didn't recognize that everybody in the restaurant was listening to us. We weren't trying to be obnoxious. We were just excited. Amen. If you're passionate about Jesus, you can't tamp it down. Amen. If it's real, it's real. Amen. Hallelujah. And Jesus is real to me. Amen. We used to sing a little song back in the day. He's real. Jesus is real to me. Hallelujah. He's real, real. Jesus is real to me. So many people doubt him, but I can't live without him. That is why I love him so. Jesus is real to me in the morning. Real, real. Oh yeah, Jesus is real to me. Oh yeah. Is he real to you? Amen. If Jesus is real to you, then his name is going to be on your lips. His praise is going to be all around you. Hallelujah. And so there was a wonderful couple. They got up from finishing their meal, and they walked by the table where we were sitting and said, you know, that was really wonderful to hear people talking about Jesus in a restaurant like this. And I said, why are you whispering? I was like, they were very quiet. They said, we were just listening to every word, and it really encouraged us. And I said, well, next time you do it too. Hallelujah. Amen. But because people need to know, hey, we are not ashamed of the gospel. Everybody else is standing up in every kind of movement you can think of, and they are shouting from the rooftop every diabolical thing that they stand for and believe in. But I want you to know the people of God will not be muzzled. We will not be silent. I'm not going to let no rock cry out for me, but I'm going to cry out the praises of God every time and every opportunity I can. Are you going to shout the Lord? Shout to the Lord. Shout to the Lord. Shout to the Lord. Shout to the Lord. Amen. You know, that's a wonderful little song that we sing. Shout to the Lord, all the earth. Let us sing. And it's, you know, got a nice little rhythm to it. Listen, are you really shouting? Amen. Don't just sing about shouting, but do some shouting. Glory. Hallelujah. Say, well, that's just emotion. Well, look, part of you is emotion, so you better get it in line with Jesus. Amen. Because we are emotional creatures. Hallelujah. So when you come to the Lord, he don't take your emotions and shut them off and make you a Christian spiritual drone. Amen. Go to the football game and see ain't there some passion out there. Hallelujah. People get emotional about all kinds of things. And so we might as well say, God, you can have my emotions. Our body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. And so every part of me, spirit, soul, and body belongs to you, Jesus. So Lord, you can have all of me, including my emotions. Hallelujah. And I want my emotions to be sanctified with your glory. And I can give a shout to you. Hallelujah. Shout to the Lord. Shout to the Lord. Shout to the Lord. Shout to the Lord. Amen. Because I'm telling you, some of the demonic mountains that we're facing in this time, we need to speak to that mountain and we need to speak loudly. Amen. And have faith in our heart and not doubt, and that mountain will be removed and will be cast into the sea. So you keep on speaking. You keep on shouting. The Lord your God is with you. Amen. The fourth question this enemy of the people of God asked is, will they finish in a day? Hallelujah. In other words, are you going to have enough time to get this done? You people, you're not going to be able to finish. I want you to know that God's design and desires for us to finish well. Philippians 1:6 says, be confident of this very thing. He who began a good work in you will complete it, will bring it to maturity until the day of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. God's not going to finish and stop until it's done. Can somebody say amen? In Isaiah 40:31, it says, those who wait on the Lord will renew their strength. They'll mount up on wings as eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and they will not faint. And so, yes, we will finish. It may not be in a day, but it's going to be finished when God says it's finished. Amen. And he will give us patient perseverance to see the fulfillment of all that he has ordained for our lives. And that fifth question he asks is, can they bring the stones back to life from these heaps of rubble, burned as they are? Some of our dreams have been dashed and they've been burned on the ash heap of things from the past. But I want you to know today, the Lord says, write the vision. Make it plain. And those who read it, including yourself, will be able to run with it. Hallelujah. It's time to write the vision again. Don't be afraid. God didn't give you a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. And it's time for us to activate the gift of faith that God has given us and begin to write and proclaim and declare the vision. Again, don't look at the burned stones. See, they had to rebuild with the stones that were there, and they had been burned by fire. And when the stones were burned, they didn't fit together properly anymore. but they were able to glean from among the rubble enough of those stones to put with the timbers where God had given them favor from the king in order to put that wall back together. It was 1.5 miles long, 8 feet thick. It was a huge wall. But I want you to know that God provided the resources even from those burned stones. What are your burned stones today? It might be a relationship that's soured. It might be disappointment in a job or a business that failed and you felt you could never recover and that you're walking around with a bag full of burned stones. But I want you to know today that God can breathe life on those stones. As he said to Ezekiel in Ezekiel chapter 37, prophesy to those dry bones, prophesy to those burned stones in the name of the Lord, and they will function. They will fit together. And what God has designed for you to build and to accomplish, it will be done in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Don't allow the enemy to undercut your confidence in the Lord. Jeremiah chapter 1 verses 8 through 10 says, do not be afraid of them, for I am with you and will rescue you, declares the Lord. Then the Lord reached out his hand and touched my mouth and said to me, I have put my words in your mouth. Verse number 10, see, today I appoint you over nations and kingdoms to uproot and to tear down and to destroy and to overthrow, but also to build and to plant. Hallelujah. It's not by might and it's not by power, but it's by my spirit, says the Lord. That God, through his spirit, gives us the ability to persevere through the difficulties, to persevere through the taunts of the enemy, to persevere through our own questioning and the feebleness of our own mind, and to rise up from the inward man and declare that our God reigns, our God is alive, hallelujah, and our God is with us. Can somebody say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians 4:13 says that we have this same spirit of faith. According as it is written, I believed and therefore I have spoken. We also believe and therefore speak. Hallelujah. Joshua had this spirit of faith. He and Caleb had a spirit of faith. Amen. When they faced the giants in the land. I want you to know that Gideon and his 300, they had this spirit of faith that they were able to accomplish with little the much that God sent them out to do. David had this spirit of faith when he stood up before Goliath and he declared, you will not come against what God has spoken. God is waiting for his church, for the people of God to stand up and to march against the gates of hell because they will not prevail. Can somebody say amen? Our sister read that scripture this morning from Matthew 16, that the purpose of the church is to go against the strategies of the enemy, not to sit and allow the taunts of the enemy to cause us to hide in safety, but the louder the enemy taunts, the more aggressive we need to stand and say, I'm going to stand and I'm going to believe God and declare his word over my community, over my nation, over my family, over my body, over my mind. Lord, give me peace in my mind. I will not allow anxiety and fear to keep me out of God's best, but I will stand and I will walk with my God. Jesus said in John 6:63, the words that I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life. God's words are spirit and they are life. And so he brings life to dead things, hallelujah, just by speaking a word. Amen. Isn't that wonderful? And so God wants us to speak his life into the earth. I'm not talking about no naming and claiming and speaking out Cadillacs and all that stuff. I'm talking about speaking the purposes of God to see people saved, to see people healed, to see people delivered, to see people baptized, to see people call on the name of the Lord, to see his glory and his righteousness and his truth and his justice return to this earth in the name of Jesus as he raises up a standard against all of the slaughter of the enemy. Glory be to God. This is our mission. This is our call. This is our destiny. This is our purpose. And the Lord is calling us to stand with him. Whose side are you standing on? I'm standing on the Lord's side. Amen. Our purpose is just to speak. God does the work. Amen. Isn't that wonderful? Jesus does all the heavy lifting. He says, just yoke up to me. Hallelujah. And I'll get the job done. You just follow me. Y'all, this is a good deal. Amen. This is a good deal. You say, well, yeah, I have to be diligent to surrender my life and my heart to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. I have to be obedient as a son of God. I have to walk out his will in my life. But the heavy lifting has already been done by Jesus when he gave his life on the cross and he arose and he said, all power and authority in heaven and earth is mine. Now I commission you, hallelujah, to go in my name and what you proclaim. I will be with the very words that you speak and they will not fall to the ground, but they will accomplish what I sent them out for. They will not return void. Hallelujah. Amen. Speak the word. Say with me, speak the word.
Speak the word.
Say it again, speak the word.
Speak the word.
One more time, speak the word.
Speak the word.
Glory to God. There's some mountains coming down. There's some valleys going to be exalted this week when you begin to speak the word of God into those situations, because our murmuring and our complaining is not going to get it done. But God has given us a spirit of faith. And this spirit of faith is able to come against all of the taunts of the enemy and undercut all of those things where he's tried to undercut our faith. So get to know God's word. Study his word. Hide his word in your heart so that you don't sin against him, so you don't miss the mark. Hallelujah. The entrance of his word brings light. Hallelujah. And when he brings light and revelation, then we're able to see beyond the mountain. We're able to see beyond the circumstance, and we're able to look over yonder and see the victory of Jesus. Hallelujah. Can you look over yonder? Amen. Amen. Or are you just looking right here? Amen. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things not seen. We have the title deed when we believe in the Lord Jesus, that over on the other side of the trial, over on the other side of the sickness, on the other side of the difficulty, on the other side of the mind-blinding stuff that the enemy brings, there is victory, and I'm going to hold on to the purpose and the word of God. Amen. Y'all, I'm just excited about Jesus. Amen. I know y'all... I know I'm probably out of time, but amen. I'm excited about the Lord. I'll cut some of this out. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Amen. We have hope. Our hope is our expectation, our confidence, and our trust. Is our trust in the Lord? I said, is our trust in the Lord?
Yes.
Glory to God. Our trust is in the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, I trust you with all of my heart, and I will not lean on my own understanding. In all my ways, I'm going to acknowledge you, so that you can direct my path. Psalm 25 verse 2 says, I trust in you. Do not let me be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me. Hallelujah. I want you to know that God will not allow the taunts of the enemy to triumph over you, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Probably Nehemiah, I'm not so sure that he would even want to be known for leading the rebuilding of the wall, because really what was most important to him was he wanted people to return to the Lord. Nehemiah would probably want to be remembered for his very first concern in Nehemiah chapter 1 verse 2 when he about the spiritual well-being of the people. They were in shame and in distress. So many times we focus on the external, the things that we can touch. And so we talk so much about the wall when we talk about Nehemiah. But Nehemiah's overarching concern was the hearts of the people, that they had been decimated. They had walked away from God and they had lost their way. And he wanted to see them restored. He wanted to see their shame and their distress, the separation from God, restored to the people of Israel. That should be our number one concern. Jesus said, the Holy Spirit, the anointing is upon me in Luke 4:18, to preach the gospel to the poor, to see captives set free, to see blind eyes open, to see prisoners released. Our purpose is to see people set free. That's what we do at Teen Challenge. Yeah, we need buildings and that stuff in order to do the work, but the focus is never on an office or building, but it's on the brokenness, it's on the shame, and it's on the distress that addiction brings into lives. When we focus on the main thing, God will see to it that those external things are provided. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all the things that you need will be added to you. God loves you. He's concerned about your life. He's concerned about those who are broken. And when we align ourselves with God's heart, He will see to it that all of your stuff is taken care of. So we don't have to focus on the stuff. Focus on the Father. Focus on His heart. Nehemiah wanted to see the shame and the distress removed from the people. He wanted to see them not following idolatry, but to really follow the living God. And when that becomes our main concern in our own lives individually and in the lives of those that we influence, then God's glory and His grace will be available to deal with all of the issues that come into our lives. I'll heal your body. I'll restore your fortunes. I will heal your family. I'll take care of those things. Align your heart with mine. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these other things will be added to you. You say, but you don't know how hard it is. No, I don't know how hard it is for you. But I want you to know that God is with you. He will never leave you, and He will never forsake you. And Jesus has been tempted in every way that we are, yet without sin. And He says, I'll walk with you through the valley. I'll walk with you through the storm. I'll walk with you through the test. And I will see to it that victory comes into your life. Do you believe that today? Do you believe that today? Hallelujah. Father, thank you for your grace. Thank you for your glory. Why don't you stand with me this morning? I just want to pray for us and just pray a prayer of blessing over the congregation. Hallelujah. Pastor Drew, I love you. The vision that God gave you for this house when you came here, He will fulfill it. There are people who made promises to you that said they were going to be here and they're not here. There are those who said, I'm going to do it. You may not be able to find them today. But God says, I'm going to send you comforters. Not like Job's comforters, but I'm going to send you some comforters who will stand with you so that the word that God has declared over this assembly, it will not return void, but it shall accomplish its full purpose. And those lives that are waiting to hear the witness of the gospel through this fellowship, they will hear it and they will see it with great power and great demonstration. Come on, give the Lord a shout of victory in the house. Hallelujah! Glory! 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 Hallelujah! Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You might say, I've been standing and waiting for my healing for a long time, and it can come any day now, and I'm happy. I want you to know that healing is coming in your direction. God said to the Apostle Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. In the time when you're weak, the power of Christ will rest on you. Day by day, moment by moment, He says, I'll give you what you need. Don't neglect to thank Him for the miracles. I almost said for the small miracles. Ain't no small, it's miracles. Because if we're yet serving Him and we're still able to give Him glory, His miracle grace is upon our lives. We might have to do it through pain, and we might have to do it through difficulty for a season, because God is a restorer. His miracle is upon you. God's miracle grace and power is resting on your life. Say with me, Lord, thank you. Come on, say it again. Lord, thank you that your grace is sufficient and that your power is resting on my life. I receive your strength right now by faith. And Lord, let the spirit of faith surround my life as I declare your word in Jesus' name. Now, Father, I thank you that as your people, we stand together as one under the banner of your grace and your mercy. Lord, let your power, let your strength be manifest. And Lord, if there's someone here today who doesn't know you, what are the great opportunity to see people baptized today, for them to come to salvation in you. If you're here today and you don't know the Lord, and you want to give your heart to the Lord, this is a great time to give your heart to Jesus. Hallelujah. And say, Lord, I want to leave the limitation of my own strength behind and embrace the unlimited potential of your grace and power in my life. If you're here this morning, you don't know the Lord, would you lift your hand? I just want to pray with you real quick. Anyone who doesn't know the Lord and say, you know, I really have strayed away and I really want to know the Lord for real, like you've been talking about today, and not just as somebody in the book. You want to know the Lord like that. Will you lift your hand? I want to pray with you today. Anyone in the congregation? Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Father, we stand as your people today. And we say, Lord, we are grateful. Lord, transform our thinking so that we don't leave the same way that we came. But Lord, we leave with hope. We leave with our faith stirred. And Lord, we leave with an action plan that we will not allow the taunts of the enemy to keep us from the best that you have for us. We give our lives away to you. We are your servants. You are our King. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Pastor.
We love this dear brother. We didn't make you play the piano today because you've been a little sick, but do you have 20 minutes in you to pray for the people? All right, so if you would like prayer, you're facing a mountain or anything else, please come up and kind of line around here, and we pastors will come behind. Board members are welcome. This brother will give you a prophetic word. He will pray, and we'll start with Brother Jimmy. Let's go this way, and then we'll come back, whatever. But if you have faith, come and pray. If you need prayer, come and pray. If we don't get to you by 12:30, because this great brother's been sick, I want to honor that, all right? We'll see you tonight at 6, because we got another great preacher tonight. We'll pray for you tonight, okay? All right, brother, you ready?
Father, thank you for your power. Thank you for your strength. In the name of Jesus. He says, I'm a God of restoration. And he says, I restore, 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 restore. I just have this picture of a house where the roof caved in. The walls were falling down. The windows, panes were all broken out. And then I saw this like extreme makeover come where everything was beautified. God says, I'm going to beautify and make new all of those things that the enemy has tried to steal from you. And he says, I'm going to restore the shell, but then I'm going to fill it up from the inside out. I'm going to fill it up with myself. He says, I'm going to come into your house, and I'm going to sup with you. I'm going to fellowship with you, and you're going to drink deeply from my anointing, and my grace and my power is more than enough.